involves two things, simple harmonic motion and waves. We're also going to draw the connection between those two things, simple harmonic motion and waves. But for the next few days, we'll focus on the first part of it, simple harmonic motion. Let me define simple harmonic motion. As I do, remember that the definition isn't going to make a lot of sense to you until I explain it. It's kind of like one of those things, I have to define a word, and then I have to define the definition. So just bear with me for a couple minutes as I read it, and then we'll tell you exactly what that means. Simple harmonic motion is motion in which the restoring force is proportional to the displacement. Well, what do we mean by that? Motion in which the restoring force is proportional to the displacement. Let me tell you what a restoring force is first. If I stretch an elastic, it requires a certain force for me to pull it. But that elastic pulls on my hand back. In fact, the elastic pulls back so that ultimately its goal is to get back to where it was. If the elastic is sitting on the table, that's its natural or equilibrium position. As I stretch it, it's pulling back so that it will get to its natural position again, right? If I let it go, then it's not going to take very long for that elastic to get back to normal, to get back to the way that it was before I stretched it. That's a restoring force, a force that's pulling it back to where it came from, pulling it back to its natural or its equilibrium position. So whenever we have a restoring force, a force pulling something back to where it started, and that restoring force gets bigger as the object gets further away from where it started, then that's simple harmonic motion. Perfect example is that elastic. When I stretch that elastic, I have to pull harder and harder and harder for the elastic to stretch more and more and more. So as the displacement of the elastic gets bigger, the force that I have to pull with gets bigger. Therefore, the restoring force, the force that's pulling back the other way, the equal and opposite force to the way that I pull, has to get bigger as the displacement gets bigger. Now, why do we call that simple harmonic motion? Because when I let that object go, if I let go of that elastic, it starts vibrating. It starts vibrating back and forth. It's motion. It results in motion that repeats itself. Now, when I do that to an elastic, the vibration dies out very, very quickly. But if I do that in other cases of simple harmonic motion, the vibration might last for a longer period of time. We think of simple harmonic motion as motion that repeats itself. But the reason we think of it that way is because of the definition which results in repetitive motion, or results in motion that repeats itself. When the force pulling it back to its natural equilibrium position, the restoring force, gets bigger as the displacement gets bigger, then, and I let it go, then the motion will repeat itself. So we're thinking of it this way. But the reason that we think of it this way or visualize it this way is ultimately because of that definition that leads to that repetitive motion. Now, what would some examples be? Besides the one that I just gave, which stretched the elastic, the force pulling the elastic back to where it came from gets bigger as I stretch it more. That's one example of simple harmonic motion, because when I let the elastic go, it vibrates a little bit. Another example of simple harmonic motion in which the restoring force is proportional to the displacement. Motion that repeats itself. All right, so you said hitting metal and it vibrates? Yeah, when I hit it, it sets up vibration, and as the metal kind of goes back and forth like this, the more it deflects from its natural straight position, the bigger the force will be pulling it back to its natural position, right? And then, therefore, at some point, the metal stops this way and starts moving the other way, back and forth, back and forth. Yeah, sure, that would work. That's simple harmonic motion. Motion that repeats itself. Why does it repeat itself? Well, because the restoring force is proportional to the displacement. Ready?
Guitar strings.
Yeah, guitar string would be similar to that, except it would be more visible, right? More noticeable. When you pluck a guitar string, it starts vibrating. And as it vibrates back and forth, back and forth, back and forth like this, the more it is away from its natural straight position, the bigger the force is pulling it back to its natural straight position. That's a restoring force that's proportional to the displacement, which means it's going to result in repetitive motion, which means it's simple harmonic motion. Yeah?
Did you say a speaker?
Yeah, a speaker in the same kind of way as the metal and the guitar. Absolutely. Back and forth, back and forth. Motion that repeats itself because as it gets further away from its natural position, the restoring force pulling it back gets bigger and bigger and bigger. I mean, in the end, the more you pull back the slingshot, the rock on the slingshot, right, you stretch the elastic, okay, that means the harder you have to pull back, right? The more you pull, the harder you have to pull back, the bigger the force. And that restoring force that pulls it back to where it came from, that restoring force is going to be exactly the same value but opposite direction to the force that you pulled it. So if that restoring force is getting bigger as you stretch it more, then when you let it go, it's going to result in repetitive motion. That's simple enough. Yeah, well, the thing is, there's also what we call damped oscillatory or damped simple amount of motion, and that means that with some things, well, with everything, but with some things in particular, some things you notice it more than others, there's a resistive force that damps out the repetitive motion very, very quickly, sometimes quicker than others, right? If I pull up something and I let it go, sometimes it goes back and forth like crazy. Sometimes it goes back and forth and dies out in a fraction of a second. That doesn't mean it's not undergoing a simple amount of motion. It just means that the energy is taken away pretty quickly. So it undergoes a simple amount of motion as it was vibrating, is it vibrating? That's it. Now, did you want? Okay, it's called Newton's cradle. I know exactly what you're talking about. I have one here. It doesn't work very well, but this thing here. Yeah, we got to be careful with that, actually, because when you do this and let it go, see, it doesn't work very well. This doesn't line up very well. We got to be careful because there's forces acting inside there during the collision. But it does lead us to a simpler example of simple harmonic motion, and that is just a straight pendulum. Okay, when I let something go, I got to look here. Back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. Repetitive motion, right? Why do we get motion that repeats itself right here? Well, because the more I pull it, the further I pull it away from its natural position, which is this position right here, the harder it pulls back to get it back to its natural position. Right? You guys know that especially if you've got something heavy on the end of the pendulum, maybe a kid on a swing, you push that kid on the swing up, right? The more you push him or her up, the harder it is to push. And the reason that it's harder to push is because that force of gravity acting down becomes more significant, right? It becomes a bigger component of the force you have to overcome. In other words, the force that you have to pull with is bigger, therefore the force that pulls it back to its natural position is bigger. As the displacement gets bigger, therefore we have simple harmonic motion. When I let it go, what happens? The motion repeats itself. Because the restoring force is proportional to the displacement. Another example would be a spring. And you guys gave me all kinds of good examples. The most commonly used ones, the ones that we see most often, would be, say, a spring. We could say an elastic as well, or something like a spring or an elastic, like the speaker somebody said, like a piece of metal, like a guitar string. Something like a spring or an elastic. Pendulum. Generally, when motion repeats itself, it's simple harmonic motion. Because generally, when motion repeats itself, it's because the restoring force, the force pulling it back to its natural position, gets bigger as the displacement gets bigger. Now, a couple terms that we've seen in our last unit, terms that we should know because we just wrote a test on circular motion yesterday. Frequency given by the symbol F. Is defined as what? I don't care if you give it to me in the context of circular motion or a more general context, doesn't really matter. Frequency is that? Sorry? The rate at which something happens? Kind of. It's defined as the number of cycles cycles, right? The number of cycles per unit time. The equation for frequency would be number of cycles over the time, just like it was in the last unit. And the units, of course, would happen to be hertz. Which one do you think I'm going to ask you next? What goes with frequency? Period. The period, given with a symbol capital T, is the time for one cycle. Last unit was specifically the time for one revolution. Now it's the time for one cycle. In context of simple body motion, it's the time that it takes to go from one spot through a complete cycle and back to where it started. The time for one complete cycle. The equation for that one would be the time over the number of cycles. And the units for that would be the second. Now remember, just like in our last unit, even those appear on the data sheet. There is one equation that relates the two together, but it does appear on the data sheet. And that would be this one, T is equal to 1 over half. Here's a quick little example. At page 345, what is the frequency of an automobile engine in which the pistons oscillate? Oscillate just means back and forth, motion that repeats itself, oscillating, in a period of 0.065 seconds. So these pistons are going up and down 0.0625 seconds it takes to go. Not up once, but up and down once. That turns, I think it's called the crankshaft underneath, okay, which ultimately, through a series of mechanical devices, ends up turning the wheels of your car. How quickly does it do it? Well, does it, or with the rate at which it does it, the frequency at which it does it? The period is 0.065 seconds, so the frequency would be 1 over the period, or 1 over 0.0625 seconds. If we flip that over, what's 0625 gives me 16. Round that to three digits, actually, 16.0 hertz. Or this piston goes up and down 16 times per second. As a result of combustion that takes place in the engine, right? The combustion builds up pressure, and that pressure causes this piston to go up and down. And the further it goes, the bigger the force is. So it ends up being motion that ends up repeating itself. Yeah, Jen? Oscillate. O-S-C-I-L-L-A-T-E. Oscillate. Just means back and forth. Causes the pistons to go back and forth in a period of 0.065 seconds. Okay? All right, have a look at these two questions. They should go very quickly in the next, let's say, 3 minutes we'll do these two questions. Get in trouble, we'll go over as a class. Let's talk about a certain type, a specific type of simple harmonic motion called a pendulum. Somebody provided that, I think it was Maddie provided that one as an example for me. Simple harmonic motion, motion that repeats itself, motion in which the restoring force acting on this object by the end of the pendulum gets bigger as it gets further away from its natural or equilibrium position. A pendulum, in general, is a device consisting of a string, or something like a string. In the case of the swinging shift and on your field trip, it wasn't a string, rather it was this big metal post that was holding the boat. The bob at the end of it would be the keys. The example that I'm showing you right now, it would be the boat on the end of that big metal pole. It consists of a string and a bob hanging from the string that swings back and forth. Back and forth, back and forth on the swing side. The period of a pendulum, like the period of any other simple harmonic motion, is the time that it takes for one complete cycle. But specifically in a pendulum, one complete cycle is from here over to here, and then back again to here. We wouldn't say if it starts right here that this would be one complete cycle. Rather, one complete cycle is back and forth, back and forth. Half a cycle, complete cycle. one and a half, two complete cycles. One complete to and fro motion of this nebulous ball. Back to where it started. So what do you think is going to affect the period of pendulum? What variables do you think are going to make the pendulum's periods bigger or smaller? What's one thing? How much time it takes this pendulum bob to go back and forth? Yeah, tell me one thing. The mass of the bob, by the way, don't write these down because I'm going to write down whatever you tell me here, and then we're going to test some of these and see which ones actually do affect it. So let's say the mass, does the mass affect it? We'll do a little test to see in just a second if the mass affects it. Maddie? The length of the string, okay, how string is longer, it's going to have a different period, now he's saying? Yep. The amount of kinetic energy, I need a little more clarification on that one, because like right now it doesn't have any kinetic energy. Now I can let this go and the kinetic energy changes this too. So what do you mean by the amount of kinetic energy? Okay, so the initial speed. So if I do push it versus just let it go, is that what you mean? Okay, so let's say initial speed. Does that work for you? Mm-hmm. Initial speed, initial kinetic energy. Yep. Okay, so let's say the initial angle then. Okay, if we say this is the equilibrium position. This would be a certain angle, theta, that it's starting at. This would be a bigger angle, right here, bigger angle theta, so the initial angle is the same. So remember, I'm not saying that any of these or all of these are correct. We're going to test as many of these as we can in a few minutes here. Anything else? Your pendulum was just chilling it, sure.
Yeah.
So far.
Okay. So then it starts to swing.
Yeah, you gotta push it to make it swing, right? You gotta cause it to swing somehow. Sure.
So when do you start counting frequency?
Okay, that's a good question. When do you start counting frequency? So Bree says, you got a pendulum that's just kind of chilling it. Okay, and then you make it move. Where do you start counting? It doesn't matter. As long as it repeats one cycle, as long as you count two when it's repeated one cycle. So if it starts right here, it's got to go back to here in order to say that's one cycle, and then you start counting again and it goes back here. But if it starts right here and then we give it a push, we would say that's one cycle because now the motion's going to repeat itself. If it starts right here and goes up a little bit, it back down, and then back up to there, that's one complete cycle. Does that make sense? So then you start counting two the next time you do that. So it doesn't matter where it starts. Up here, one complete cycle. Down here, it's pushed up here, one complete cycle. Yeah?
Are we always going to have this on this?
Oh, good question. So you're saying gravity. That's what you're getting at there, right?
Yeah.
Is gravity going to matter? We'll say the acceleration of gravity, right? So gravitational fluids, right?
Yeah.
Okay, that's a good one. Anything else? Yeah?
Just a question, what about pendulum?
Yep.
What if it doesn't make it too late? If it just has max, what if it doesn't make it too bad another time? We just had to do like the middle piece.
Sorry, say it again.
So like if you measure a cycle from like the top and it doesn't make it to the top again.
Yeah, well the reality is it won't actually make it quite as high as it started because you're going to lose a little bit of energy in that process of converting. But unless it's too damped, and we talked about damped in supermodic motion before, unless it's losing too much energy, it's going to make it close. So even if it doesn't make it quite to the height, it then makes it almost to the height, we'd say the point at which, like if we started up here from rest, the point at which it changes direction up here again would be one complete cycle. Yeah. Let's try these. Okay, let's test these. Let's test all of them except for this. We know that gravity is going to make a difference on unfortunately, we can't test that without going to the moon or going to space, so we don't have the resources to do that. So we're gonna just tell you the gravity matters. If you're on the moon, the greater pendulum is different than if you're on the Earth. In fact, if you're to talk about Everest, the greater pendulum will be ever so slightly different because the gravitational field strength is a little bit less, not that much, but a little bit less at the top of Mount Everest. All right, now that we've done our little experiment to test the effect of mass on period of the pendulum and length of period of the pendulum and initial speed, initial angle, let's see what our results turned out to be here. Who tested mass? Liam's group, Cindy's group, Maddie's group, and Taylor's group. Liam, what did you guys find? Mass matter?
Yes.
Mass did matter?
Yeah, yes.
All right, what about Cindy's group? Did you guys find mass matter? A tiny little bit?
Yeah.
Maddie's group? What was your, so you said 0.2 seconds, what was your, 0.2 seconds compared to 0.3 is what we're big, right? But 0.2 compared to 10 is what
it's. 1.5.
Okay, so not that much. Taylor? You guys find that it didn't matter? Yeah, I asked you this experiment so quickly that there's gonna be some imprecision with it, right? And that's what's gonna lead us being off by a little bit. The reality is it should not matter. The mass should not matter. So if you found that there was a slight difference, well, it's because you weren't particularly precise with your experiment, but you did it in 10 minutes. If you were off by a lot, then you were really not precise with your experiment. So that you were holding that mass up in the same spot by look, then maybe that wasn't close enough. Maybe you should have been a little more precise in your control of the other areas. Mass does not matter. What about the length of the pendulum? Who did that one? Liam's group again. What did you guys find out?
Yeah.
It did matter, for sure?
Yeah.
Maybe.
Cindy, what did you guys find?
Did
it matter? Okay.
Yeah, it did.
Taylor? It did matter? Megan? It did matter? Yeah, it should matter. Okay. Length is a fairly significant thing. Just like G, just like gravity is a fairly significant thing. But we're going to skip one for a second, go to the initial angle. Who did the initial angle? Maddie, did you guys find that the initial angle matter? No. Okay. Megan? You guys found that it did not? Kyle? It did not matter? Okay. Good. It should not matter. Now, I say that the initial angle actually does matter, but such a minuscule amount at relatively small angles that we say it doesn't matter. We don't even include it in the equation. But if we make our angle big enough, then it becomes much more significant. If I swing my keys, or if I swing my bob on the end of this string, okay, like this, if I start with an angle like this, measured from the vertical, maybe 10 degrees, you can kind of time this in your head, right? Start, stop, start, stop. You don't know how much time that is, but you can compare that to another time. Start, stop. Increase my angle quite a bit, right, to about 40 degrees here. Start, stop. Small angle. Start, stop. Big angle, start, stop. Same thing, isn't it? But if I increase it to a really high value, watch. Start, stop. So when we're at big angles, above 40, 45 degrees, it starts becoming more significant. But we won't do problems involving big angles. We'll always do problems involving relatively small angles where the initial angle doesn't matter, or at least it doesn't matter enough to make any difference to include it. Now the last one, we only have one group do this, initial speed. And you guys, I think, found that the initial speed did matter, right? Okay. Let's try that as a group here, again, just with our little anecdotal timing here, our start-stop thing. Okay. We're going to start with an initial speed of 0 at this angle, which is about 30 degrees. Start, stop. Now I'm going to give it a little bit of a push from 30 degrees so that it has an initial speed. Does that make sense? Start, stop. Drop it, start, stop. Push it, start, stop. It's pretty much the same, isn't it? Yeah, and the reason that it's pretty much the same is because by giving it a bit of a push, all I'm doing is effectively dropping it from higher. And if the angle doesn't matter, then the initial speed, therefore, wouldn't matter either. Does that make sense? The initial speed does not matter. I say that, but if you make your initial speed big enough, it is going to matter, right? Just like if you make your initial angle big enough, it is going to matter. The only two things that we found matter really significantly at relatively small angles are the length and the gravitational field strength. I'm going to give you an equation right now for the period of a pendulum. Looks like this, kind of an ugly little thing. T is equal to 2 pi, and this comes from the sinusoidal nature of repetitive motion, 2 pi square root L over G, T being the period of the pendulum, and that's going to be measured in seconds, L being the length of the pendulum, and that's going to be measured in meters, and G being 9.81 of the gravitational field strength, 9.81 meters per second squared. Although we will put a little star by that, because if you happen to get on a planet or on the top of Mount Everest or on the moon, then that 9.81 is going to be a little bit different, right? Or a lot different, depending upon where you are. That's a good question. Are you going to have any questions where we're not on the surface of the Earth? If you're on or near the surface of the Earth, like you were at the amusement park, for instance, a couple of weeks ago when you did your field trip, you might not have been on the surface of the Earth because you were up in the air, right? But you're close enough that we can make G 9.81 meters per second squared. If you're on the moon, it's not 9.81, it's about 1.6. You either have to be, you could get a question like that, absolutely. You either have to be given the value of the gravitational field strength, or you can turn around and use G is equal to big G N over R squared from our last unit to find the gravitational field strength. That makes sense? Okay, I want to show you how to rearrange this one because it is a little bit ugly with that square root and with the G on the bottom and so on. So, let's do some algebra here and rearrange this. By the way, this is the form of the equation that appears on the data sheet. What I'm about to show you does not appear on our data sheet. It's just that because the algebra is a little bit tricky on this, I want to work through it with you as opposed to just set you up on your own. Let's take the 2 pi over by dividing. Multiplied by square root L over G. Let's take a look at dividing. By the way, we're solving for L here first, solving for L. Let's take the square root over the other side by squaring. So it becomes T over 2 pi squared equals L over G. Now we want to solve for L. Let's take the G over to the other side by times. So we're going to say G times T over 2 pi, the G is outside the brackets here, right, equals L. There's another equation. It's really just a rearranged form of the red one. This one does not appear in the data sheet, so be able to rearrange it to solve for L. Now, if we want to solve for little g, we just take this equation that we just found and do well with it. I'll give you a hint. It's a one-stepper. At this point, it's one-stepper. Yeah, got it. No, we can't solve the G in the L, no. What?
L divided by T over
2
pi.
Yeah, we got this term here, T over 2 pi bracket squared, it's multiplied by G. So to take it to the other side, we're going to divide. So G becomes equal to L over T over 2 pi. Let's square that. Looks like this. That also is not on the data sheet, but it's also something that's pretty useful to you because there's times you're going to have to solve. In fact, in the first example that we're going to do just a moment, we have to find the real G using this algebra, this equation, and this rearrangement. Okay, last example of the day, page 379, says, what's the gravitational field strength at the top of Mount Everest that has an altitude of 8,954 meters? Pendulum with a length of 1 meter is a period of 2.01 seconds. You know what, here last summer, I climbed a mountain in, fallen mountain, I guess, Big Hill, whatever. It was about 800 meters in elevation. That's pretty big, right? Pretty high. Mount Everest is 8,954. So if I climbed 10 of those, that would be like climbing Mount Everest, right? I think I could do 10 of those. Somehow I think Mount Everest might be a little bit harder to climb than 10 little hikes. 8,954 4 meters, depending on the length of 1.0 times 1.0 meters, and has a period of 2.01 seconds. I could, if I wanted to, solve for the gravitational field strength using this equation. And Braden alluded to this earlier, right? Could we use this? Sure. We know the mass of the Earth. We know 8,954 above sea level plus the radius of the Earth. We could absolutely do that. That's not what we're going to do here, because I want to focus on pendulum that we just showed you. But this is a valid equation. Let's look at the pendulum equation now. T is equal to 2 pi square root L over g. Let's solve for little g. 2 pi goes over by dividing. And then we square it. T over 2 pi squared equals L over g. And then we swap. We take the g out by multiplying. And then the t over 2 pi down by dividing. So g becomes L over t over 2 pi squared. Now let's sub our numbers in here. We'll plug this into the calculator to make sure that you can do it properly no matter what. L is 1 meter. T is 2.01 seconds. 2 times pi. Let's do this here. Do it in this order, unless you're really, really, really good with the calculators. And honestly, most of you think you're better with your calculators than you really are. Unless you know you're really, really good with it, then do it this way. Go 2 pi first. Get the number on the bottom first. It equals 6.28. And then say 2.01 divided by that number on the bottom. Gives me 0.3199. So that's what's inside the brackets. Then let's square what's inside the brackets. 0.102. And then say 1 over that. Gives me 9.77. So the gravitational field strength at the top of Mount Everest would be 9.77. Versus what is it here at base of Mount Everest, or at roughly at sea level? About 9.81. Does that make sense? It's 9.77 with a lower at the top of Mount Everest. How come it's lower? Because it's higher, so that means that if you're at the top of Mount Everest, you're further from the center of the Earth. What would the units be here, by the way? Units? Two sets of units we can use here at this point, right? Yeah, meters per second squared works good. What else? The order mass unit. What? Newtons per kilogram. Either one of those would work. So you specify, you only specify one of those two. Okay, your homework. Three questions on page 379, please.